Good morning, afternoon, evening, wherever you guys are in the world, welcome back to the channel. Appreciate you guys swinging by today for some more good stuff. Now, today we're gonna be talking about horsepower. Now, there's such a common misconception that I've seen throughout uploading the past year between the differences of brake horsepower, crank horsepower, and wheel horsepower, which all of them have different readings. You can take like the STI behind me, for example, and get different readings between all three of those units of measurement. Now, I can see where the confusion comes in a little bit because they all have the word horsepower in them, but they're all different units of measurement essentially. So before we even get into going into the differences between each set of horsepowers, we're gonna go way back. We're gonna go way back to the early 18th century where horsepower originated. So in the early 18th century, there was a man called Mr. James Watts, or just James Watts throughout this. We'll just call him Watts though. So Mr. Watts used to work on steam powered engines, specifically with trains, trying to increase the efficiency of them because everyone wanted to be more efficient. They wanted to be able to go farther with less fuel. At the time, the fuel was coal because it's a steam powered engine. So he needed to find a way to give a definition to the unit of efficiency for steam powered engines. Now, what Mr. Watts was working with at the time was horses, obviously, because horses were everywhere. People used horses to travel, they used them to move things, they used them to haul things and to ride them, because who didn't want to ride a horse in the early 18th century, I guess? Not me, I don't like horses, I don't trust horses. Any animal that wears shoes, I can't trust. But Mr. Watts wanted to find a unit of measurement to measure that efficiency. So what he did is he set up a test. Now, one mechanical horsepower isn't really used, or mechanical horsepower in general isn't really used anymore to measure efficiency or horsepower rating so much. Typically it's what we talked about, like brake horsepower, crank, or wheel horsepower. Now, one mechanical horsepower is a unit of measurement of equivalent to 550 pounds being lifted 1 foot per 1 second. There's a secondary part of the equation that just kind of ups that to a minute, but it just changes the values. We don't really need to go into that. Now, this is also referred to as imperial horsepower, which breaks down to 745.7 watts of energy, because watts is also a unit of measurement. You also might have heard of Mr. Watts before because he's kind of tied to like 60 watt light bulb kind of stuff, but that's totally beside the point. So we know that one mechanical horsepower is 745.7 watts. We don't really need to know that for anything else, but it's just good to know. So that is mechanical horsepower. It's the ability to lift 550 pounds 1 foot per 1 second. We're gonna start breaking down the differences between brake horsepower, crank horsepower, and wheel horsepower. Now, typically when you go out and you buy a car from a manufacturer, Subaru, Audi, Volkswagen, Ford, Chevy, whoever it is, most of them are going to be measured in brake horsepower. Not so much on the European side, I guess, because they do it a little bit differently. But the way brake horsepower is measured is it's the engine's not attached to anything. It is put up on a dynamometer where it just kind of bolts up to where the flywheel would bolt up, and it measures power that way. But the thing that kind of differentiates brake horsepower from crank horsepower is brake horsepower is typically altered a little bit with maybe the power steering pump removed, maybe it's on there, AC may or may not be on there. So all of the extra accessories that go on the engine may or may not be on there, which kind of gives a rough estimate of how much brake horsepower the engine is producing. It's not necessarily the purest way of knowing it, but it is more of a realistic expectation than what crank horsepower might be. So when you see something, we'll take my STI for example, from the factory it comes with 305 brake horsepower. That is going to be the amount of horsepower that the engine is producing without the drivetrain loss, because you are going to have drivetrain loss through front wheel drive, all wheel drive, rear wheel drive. It's going to vary from drivetrain to drivetrain to drivetrain. Now, there are calculators online that if you wanted to, I will link one down below in the description if you guys want to go play with it a little bit, that will convert brake horsepower or crank horsepower over into wheel horsepower and vice versa going back the other way. So that way, if you guys want to get a rough estimate of what your drivetrain loss might actually be, you guys can get a pretty good understanding of that. Typically, there's like generalities that people follow. I'm not going to get into them because I don't want them to be taken as gospel or anything like that, but you can do a search on those if you want to. So just to wrap up brake horsepower, it's essentially how much power the engine makes with a degree of resistance put onto the engine. Now for crank horsepower, because this is where people get a little disconnected from one or the other. So as I touched on before, you have drivetrain loss that goes from your transmission through the drive shaft, through the rear diff, and then through the axles, obviously. If you're all wheel drive, add another diff up front and add two more axles. You are going to lose horsepower from your drivetrain. You are going to get robbed. Automatic transmission cars suffer from this a little bit more from their torque converters. Their torque converter will rob a little bit more power from the car than a manual transmission would. That's also going to heavily vary from vehicle to vehicle to vehicle though. And your drivetrain type too, don't forget that one. Now, people describe crank horsepower as the purest way to measure an engine's power figures, which I totally get where they're coming from with that one. Typically, it's going to be the engine strapped up to a dynamometer without any of the accessories, such as alternator, power steering, any of that stuff on the engine. So that way you can measure the purest, biggest amount of horsepower that that engine is producing. These typically don't get done in any of the aftermarket world unless people are building a very specific motor with a lot of custom modification done to it. So now we're going to get into wheel horsepower, which is, this is probably the most common that I see in the aftermarket world is wheel horsepower. So with wheel horsepower, it's pretty much exactly what it sounds like. It's how much power is being put down to the wheels of the vehicle. You guys might be familiar with this as it's how we tuned the BRZ on the first go around. It's also how we tuned the STI twice. The car was strapped onto a dynamometer, which measures how much wheel horsepower and wheel torque the car is putting out. It's essentially those big rollers, they strapped on the car, they let it go up like full chooch, they let it come back down, and that spits out a reading, and then you like copy paste repeat until you get a final tune, and then you get your final wheel horsepower numbers and your final wheel torque number. Now I want everyone to take wheel horsepower numbers and wheel torque numbers with a huge grain of salt. Huge grain of salt. It doesn't matter if your car was hooked up to one dyno and you got like these readings, we'll say the STI, we'll use the STI for example. That car made 401 wheel horsepower, 388 foot-pounds of torque on a Mustang dyno. Now every dyno that you go to is going to be calibrated differently, and it's going to be, it may or may not be a different brand dyno. Both of these factors are going to play a huge role in what your wheel horsepower numbers are and what your wheel torque numbers are. If a dyno is completely calibrated differently than another one, even if they're the same brand, if you have a Mustang dyno here, it's calibrated per the book, and then you have another Mustang dyno here and it's calibrated differently, you could strap the car down on both dynos and it's going to make two drastically different numbers. So take dyno numbers with a huge grain of salt, because that's not going to be your 100% gospel of how much the car makes. It is going to be a good estimate. If you really wanted to, you go from dyno to dyno to dyno, take all those numbers, average them up, and that would be a pretty close representation of what the car probably is making. But just remember that every dyno is going to be different. Now with wheel horsepower is going to factor in that drivetrain loss, because you have the car strapped onto these rollers that measure the resistance. So you are getting the actual wheel horse, how much power is going to the wheels versus how much is just going to the crank. So when they say that an STI from the factory makes 305 horsepower, they're talking about crank horsepower. That translates down to about 260 wheel horsepower. So even though the sticker on the window of your car, even though it says 305 horsepower, the car's not making 305 horsepower to the wheels. So keep that in mind as you guys hear things. Keep an ear out for it. If you're watching a video or if you're talking to someone online and they specify crank horsepower or wheel horsepower, those numbers are going to be drastically different. Essentially, crank horsepower is not going to factor in drivetrain loss. Wheel horsepower is going to factor in drivetrain loss, as well as like accessories on the motor. If you have alternator, power steering pump, AC. Have you ever been driving your car, you turn the AC on and it feels like it lost a little bit of power? It's your accessories robbing some power from the motor to be able to run those accessories. But didn't want this video to be crazy long. I did want to clarify those up though, so hopefully this helped you guys out. Hopefully you learned something new, and if you did, consider subscribing, because only 30% of you guys that watch the videos are actually subscribed to the channel, and your boy always appreciates it. Always appreciates it. And if you guys want to support the channel, feel free to swing over to the website www.smeedia.net. Grab yourself a drive hoodie, grab a t-shirt, a jet tag, anything you guys want to hook it up. Your boy always appreciates it. But that's all I got for you guys on this one. So if you like the video, you know what to do. Go ahead, hit that like button and turn it blue, like the chassis on the Subaru. And if you're not already subscribed to the channel, hit your boy up one of these corners. No idea which one I'll put it in quite yet. But with that though, I will catch you guys in the next one. Peace out, homies.